U.S. Vice President Joe Biden says the United States and Turkey are prepared for a military solution against Islamic State in Syria if the Syrian government and rebels are unable to reach a political one.
We do know that it would be better if we could reach a political solution, but we are prepared. We're prepared, if that's not possible, to have a military solution to this operation.
The U.S. Congress has quietly moved forward with an authorization for use of military force against ISIS. Also known as an AUMF, it is required by law to conduct military operations longer than 90 days. The proposed legislation is already being referred to as a Declaration of International Martial Law and an Unlimited War Powers Act for the President.
This resolution is a total rewrite of the War Powers Clause of the United States Constitution. Let's be clear about that. It is essentially a declaration of international martial law, a sweeping transfer of military power to the president that will allow him or her to send U.S. troops almost anywhere in the world for almost any reason with absolutely no limitations. Now, Article 1, Section 8, Clause 11 of the Constitution, it vests in Congress the responsibility to declare war. Now, many of us on both sides of the aisle have been arguing for over a year that the president right now has exceeded his constitutional authority in continuing military operations against ISIS without specific authorization from Congress.
The current military campaign against ISIS is now officially a year old and has been conducted without an authorization of force by Congress, which technically makes our campaigns in Syria and Iraq illegal. That's right, illegal. And that's why they're pushing to pass this law now, just like the other laws they pass that violate our Constitution. The USA Freedom Act, the US Patriot Act, the NDAA, so on and so forth. Illegal and nobody cares.
What's wrong with you?
Your station is corrupt.
Okay. Are you some kind of a constitutionalist?
This administration attempted to propose an authorization for use of military force with restricted ground operations, but that was rejected by Congress. As you can see in this article dated January 10th, the Senate Majority Leader reiterated his objection to the president's proposed authorization of force. However, last Wednesday, that all changed. Now, all of a sudden, they want war. On top of that, yesterday we had the vice president in front of a camera on the world stage quoted as saying expanded military operations were well in the works. So they've decided to go back to war in Iraq to send troops to Syria, and we just don't know it yet. Pockets of ISIS are now believed to exist in Mali, Libya, Egypt, Tunisia, Somalia, Lebanon, Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, and in most European countries. We could be bombing radicals in London the day after this authorization takes effect. Think about that. This authorization of force extends the endless war on terror to every country where we fund terrorism. Let me say that again. This authorization of force extends the endless war on terrorism to every country where we fund terrorism.
What's wrong with you?
Your station is corrupt.
Okay. Are you some kind of a constitutionalist?
Can you tell us what the total number of trained fighters remains?
It's a small number, and the ones that are in the fight is we're talking four or five.
Are we going to supply air support for the people we train to fight ISIL?
We are, Senator.
Do those same people want to take Assad down?
We're talking four or five.
The ones that we are supporting right now are focused on ISIL.
Do they have a goal to take Assad down?
Senator, I don't know.
What do you mean you don't know?
Well, the ones we're supporting, I don't know because...
It's a small number.
Do you think most people in Syria want two things? They want to fight, they want to destroy ISIL and get rid of Assad, the person who's killed 250,000 of their family? Is that really a mystery?
No, it's not.
It's not a mystery. Okay, is Russia going to fight for Assad?
Russia is fighting for Assad.
Will Iran fight for Assad?
They are doing that, sir.
Will Hezbollah fight for Assad?
They are doing that.
When the people we train to fight ISIL turn on Assad, which they surely will, are we going to fight with them? to replace Assad?
I can't answer that question, Senator.
Can you answer it, Secretary Carter?
Yeah, just to be clear, let's take the...
That day is coming.
EG, Kurds, it, well, I the...
Do you see a scenario where the people in Syria don't take on Assad?
The people that we are equipping...
It's a small number.
...are people who live in or come from ISIL-occupied territory. And
do they want to take Assad down?
I'm defeating ISIL.
Do they want to take Assad down?
For the most part, they're focused on defeating...
Do they want to take Assad? Have you asked them?
We know what their intent is, and it is to fight ISIL.
Come on.
They're fighting ISIL now.
You know as well as I do, both of you know, that the average Syrian not only wants to destroy ISIL, but they're intent on destroying Assad because he's killed 250,000 of them. And here's the question for this committee. How do we leverage Assad leaving when Russia's going to fight for him, Iran's going to fight for him, Hezbollah's fight for him, and we're not going to do a damn thing to help people take him down?
The Russians are conducting military operations in the Middle East for the first time since World War II.
So that's so
bombing
that's,
the people that we are supporting.
It's a small number.
Steve, let me just say this.
It's an embarrassment.
So with the additional steps I ordered last month, we're speeding up training of ISIL forces.
A shocking story today, everyone, in the Wall Street Journal. It says our American dollars may be getting into the hands of ISIS.
ISIL forces.
The money is reportedly getting funneled through Iraq's central bank into Iranian banks and then possibly to terrorists.
It's an embarrassment.
What should be done, what can be done in this latest chapter, the saga of ISIS getting control over our weapons, now perhaps our money.
A secret analysis by the agency you ran, the Defense Intelligence Agency, in August 2012 said, and I quote, there is the possibility of establishing a
That's
declared or undeclared Salafist, it's not secret anymore, was released under FOI. The quote is, there is the possibility of establishing a declared or undeclared Salafist principality in eastern Syria, and this is exactly what the supporting powers to the opposition want in order to isolate the Syrian regime. Your agency was saying, quote, the Salafists, the Muslim Brotherhood and Al-Qaeda in Iraq are the major forces driving the insurgency in Syria. Mm-hmm. In 2012, the US was helping coordinate arms transfers to those same groups. Why did you not stop that? You are basically saying that even in government at the time, you knew those groups were around, you saw this analysis,
sure,
and you were arguing against it, but who wasn't listening?
I think the administration.
The administration turned a blind eye to your analysis.
I don't know if they turned a blind eye. I think it was a decision. I think it was a willful decision.
A willful decision to go support an insurgency that had Salafists, Al-Qaeda,
well,
and Muslim
a willful
Brotherhood.
Decision to do what they're doing. Which you have to really ask the president, what is it that he actually is doing with the policy that is in place?
Why did you allow them to do that, General? You were in post. You were the head of the Defense Intelligence Agency.
Well, those are policy.
I took the liberty of printing out that document.
So let's get the obvious out of the way. One half of our government still thinks it's the 1980s and that the Cold War never ended. Then there's the other part of our government, the Obama part, the radical Islamist sleeper cell part. So on the one hand, you have the Republicans in Congress waging a Cold War, and on the other hand, you have a terrorist in the White House waging a covert war against the American people. Obama bin Laden is his name, and terrorizing the American public is his game. How do we know? Well, let's check our list to see who's been naughty or nice. Who opened the borders? Obama, check. Who set up sanctuary cities? Obama, check. Who fired half the generals in the military? Double check. Who doubled the debt? Check again. Who fucked up healthcare and made it twice as expensive? Triple check. Who destroyed American families? Check. Who signed free trade agreements that ships jobs overseas? Check. Who ships guns and money to terrorists? Check. Who put in place free speech zones? Check. Who militarized the police so our country could look like Nazi Germany? Check. There's one thing missing from our list, however. Obama bin Laden still hasn't dragged us into World War III. But don't you worry, they're on the road to success. They're mooning the Chinese and they're shining the Russians. They're just begging for a war. First, they staged a revolution in Ukraine, but that didn't work. Then they downed MH17 and went as far as to blame the Russians when it was obvious that they had nothing to gain from that situation. But that didn't work, so they started buzzing the Chinese military bases, and even that didn't work. But recently, they downed Flight 9268. That, however, might work. But you're saying to yourself, well, that was ISIS. I saw it on the TV. Well, ladies and gentlemen, ISIS is a subsidiary of the United States government. Haven't you been watching the news? They have been bought and paid for with our tax dollars. But why, you say, why? Osama bin Laden wants to destroy America to avenge the injustices of his ancestors and to set up an Islamic super state for his brotherhood. What we need here, ladies and gentlemen, is a law that allows us to recall our elected officials. Countries do that all the time. Even the state of California can recall their governor. And why do they do that? Because you can't trust a politician. We need to be able to dissolve government and call special elections like every other country can. We can even call it the total recall provision. If companies can fire an employee, then we should be able to fire a politician, especially one as treasonous as Osama bin Laden. That's the only way, folks. You wouldn't buy a car without test driving it first, would you? Well, we should be able to test drive our politicians just the same. We give them until summer, and if we don't like the sound they're making, well, we can just re-vote in November. It'd be the same price with twice the guarantee. 4 years in office is far too long for a tyrant. Elected officials keep thinking they can just take us for a ride. Well, there'll be no free ride, no free lunch with the Total Recall program. Total Recall. Write your congressman or congresswoman today. That's Total Recall. Putting people back in charge of their government. Total Recall. Call today.